Thank you very much. Just continue on, enjoy your lunch, because I'm gonna be talking about what we eat. It's a great pleasure to be here at Northwestern. Two of my children are in the process of becoming doctors and is a doctor. Graduated from Northwestern University, it's really glad to be here again. Yeah, one thing I want to say at the beginning, so I got to hear the other cardiologist talk, that he did a great talk, and I think also, what I want to tell you when I talk about any changes you'll make in your diet, and I'm gonna try to encourage you, we all can use changes in our diet, but cancer is a very complicated illness, so if you're gonna make changes in your diet, I think you should do that with the direction of your doctor. In other words, even some of the things I say about absorption of food and things, clear it there, but it can affect how you absorb food, your minerals, iron, different things, it can affect the gut. So you want to really talk to the great doctors here at Northwestern about your illness and how changing your diet may help you. So that being said, who in the room's ever heard of so-called, what we call it, what I call it, a whole food plant-based diet? Great, because that's really what I'm going to be talking about today. And talking about it more largely in the sense of how it can benefit many illnesses. And we don't have any really trials of changing diet in scleroderma specifically, and not whole food plant-based diet in scleroderma specifically. But what I can tell you about the diet more largely, it helps prevent a number of illnesses, which is going to be important for all of us. And two, the diet inhibits inflammation, which is something in scleroderma very important to be on a low inflammation type diet. I think it helps in terms of the illness more largely. So I think it's a very safe diet for everybody, but I want you to do it in the context of your diet. So when I talk about a whole food plant-based diet, I'm gonna show some pictures of that. So what is that specifically? And specifically, what I'm talking about is not eating animals, number one. Any kind of animals. We say nothing but the face. Because, you know, a shrimp is an animal, chicken is an animal, beef is an animal, so we try not to eat animals at all. And try not to eat things such as dairy, associated, that comes from animals. So what does that leave? So we start out here, leaves a lot of things, but leaves any kind of vegetables of huge variety, and once you start realizing that what you're going to eat, then you have a bigger variety of things you may not even thought you liked in the past, you may start to like. But then you also want to eat other things like potatoes, beans, lentils, legumes. So what I'm not trying to get you to do is just eat lettuce. You'll starve, you know? Who wants to just eat lettuce? You may have a next slide here is just an example of, so your doctor told you to eat more greens. So there's some kale, that's me, I grew these in my garden, okay? So does that look like a lot of kale? That's really one serving. When you boil it down, it becomes really small. But even in general, you're supposed to eat, you know, 5 to 7 helpings of vegetables and fruit a day. So this would be an example of where we're going with this. This is a little bit, I'm just gonna show you a few pictures from my own garden. And this is just in a little box, a growing box that helps extend your growing season. This is just a box in my front yard, growing all kinds of greens, large variety. Look at that, that's some type of kale or broccoli. There's some grass. This is the, so here's the neighbor's yard in my front yard just in the spring. And you can see that I got all this growing, but my neighbor, all he's got is grass. He's got nothing to eat. He has to come to my yard to get the spinach and the greens and such. And here's as the garden progresses, the onions and greens and all this stuff. So this is just something we did in the front yard. Look at how that spinach is coming along just beautifully. Now, do any of you have gardens? Who's got a garden? All right. So, I just wanted to, for those of you who have a garden, I wanted to make sure I brought some kale today. You got a practice bunch of trees. This is a trip this morning. So who's got a garden? Come on down. I want to do some of my own. Come on down. I'll take it home with you. So, why eat kale? What I find most of the time when people are eating kale, they're like, oh, I got to eat kale. Can I make a smoothie? Then you put like a peaches and watermelon, bananas in it, a little piece of kale and grind it up and drink it. So we're really not trying to get you to do smoothies, because when you eat whole food and plant-based, there's tremendous fiber, there's tremendous minerals, and actually chewing helps you absorb that. So if you just put in a blender, you're getting rid of all the fiber and you're just drinking carbohydrate, period. That's all you're getting. So I really want you to chew your food, take your time preparing it that way. So it's not, here's a watermelon. Watermelon's really good for you. This grew in the front yard, and it's got tremendous vitamins, fiber, and things. So trying to get your mindset a little bit changed that you'll still have things to eat. If we do this, this is things really taking off. Now, this is Brian Rippon. He's a neighbor of mine, and he helps me in the garden because when you have a garden, it has weeds. It's like after we were thrown out of Eden, then the weeds came. In the original garden, there was no weeds. So I just want to say a little bit about that, about the fact that I have to have someone help me weed, help me garden. So if you think about it, what goes on in the country, I live up in Wisconsin, so fields and fields of corn. So if you go into my soil and you dig up the dirt, and just take one shovel full, you know, 10, 15 worms in my soil, because I'm not using any fertilizer or herbicide or anything like that. I'm just using the mulch and things from the yard. Now, if you go in Kenosha County out in the cornfields and you put your spade in the ground, first of all, if you look down the corn rows, there's nothing. There's not one weed. It's all GMO corn. And the reason it's GMO corn is because then you can put all the pesticides on top of it. And then the one plant that's genetically modified to go through that pesticide will give corn. So let me give you a little bit of the cycle of this. So you can grow massive amounts of corn with no weed. By the way, you wouldn't want to plant a garden where they plant that corn because everything's dead. There's no organisms. There's no weeds. Nothing grows except that corn. Okay? So you plant all that corn, and you got so much corn, you give it to the livestock. Okay? Well, actually, livestock aren't supposed to eat corn. They're supposed to eat grass. So they can't handle that GI-wise. So they can't handle it GI-wise. They're in close quarters, and you have to put on antibiotics. In fact, 80% of the antibiotics used in the world are used in animal agriculture, not in humans. So we're getting a lot of resistance by using all this. So you feed it to the cows, and the cows, people eat the cows. Then people get heart disease. Okay? So when they get heart disease, they come to the hospital, put a stent in them, put a balloon in them, do bypass surgery. So this is what's going on, but who's setting the dietary guidelines on what you're supposed to eat? Take a guess.
USDA.
USDA, yes. So the USDA, their mission, if you look at their preamble, is to promote agriculture and producing animals. It's not to prevent illness. Okay? So they set the, and that's why you see things like, if you look at the American Heart Association, you can have heart disease, look at their healthy diet. It's got a fructose diet. Okay? So eating cattle is highly associated with colon cancer. Eating chicken and dairy, highly associated with breast cancer, prostate cancer. Just going back to that cycle, everything, I live in the epiculture where we're going all this corn to do all this stuff. So if you go on a whole food plant-based diet, what happens in terms of heart disease? Yeah, you, Dr. Campbell, wrote a book on this, and then Dr. Dean Ornish was able to show reversal of heart disease by eating a plant food, a whole food plant-based diet. So heart disease, and now in the last couple of years we've been able to do imaging inside the coronary arteries, see the plaque, put someone on a plant-based diet, lower their cholesterol, go back and image, and the blockages have gone away. So getting back to this, what are we doing with the agriculture? It's right going on. So let's go through a little further. More beautiful squash, peppers, tomatoes, all these things. This is just my own compost pile. If you're on the inner circle, you come to the house, I'll show you the compost pile. So,
oh, wow.
These are just different ways to grow potatoes, things. I just want to come up here a little bit. Okay, so I'm going to switch. I got more than food pictures to show you. That's just the 100. So what illnesses, I mentioned a few that reverse with heart disease. So about 80% of the illnesses that patients go to the hospital for, 80% of the illnesses, such as hypertension, stroke, heart attack, osteoporosis, cancer, are prevented by eating whole food, plant-based. And the evidence is good for that. You find that kind of striking. For instance, in the United States, there's 22,000 cardiologists. How many of them are in their own lives eating whole food, plant-based? Mm-hmm. Means I can count, because we kind of know each other, probably about 25, 30 out of 22,000. So what I'm saying is your doctor may not really have the training. Most doctors get about an hour on nutrition when they go to medical school, and not much after that. In cardiology, there's no requirement for nutrition. And yet we know that this is the basis. So when you eat plant-based, we're eating about 10% fat, 10% protein, just by nature of eating vegetables. So, let's take a look at that. So what's that more specifically look like? Look at plant-based and animal-based. Let's look at cholesterol. So in the plant-based, almost no cholesterol, almost no fat. Look at protein. Just the same amount of protein in plant-based. One of the most common things people ask me, well, what about your protein? We've been programmed, oh, you might be protein deficient. Protein, when you eat it, animal protein, it turns on genes, it turns on coronary disease. And if you quit eating it, that those genes then turn off coronary disease. So the reason we're, and look at all the vitamins and minerals you're getting. Look at that beta-carotene, getting 29,000. Micrograms in meat, 17. Getting vitamin C and folate, all these things that are so healthy just by eating plant-based. It's also less calories. So if you're eating plant-based, you get to eat more, not less. This is the 10 leading causes of death. Heart disease, cancer, stroke. But all of these that are checkmarked are associated with eating meat and dairy. there's causes of death, which, by the way, just for full disclosure here, hospital errors is third leading cause of death in the United States, hospital errors. Is it because the doctors are not smart? No, it's not because of that. It's because things that we do, procedures that we do, hospital-based infections, all these other things, they go in the hospital, there's a risk of that. So it'd be better if you didn't have illness, you didn't have to go to the hospital. So let's go. Here's the leading causes top 10 causes of disease in the United States. Again, the majority of them are related to eating that. You can see our obesity is going up. Folks, I want to tell you, it's the reason it's going up is because of the food. It's because of the food. I mentioned before, we take the corn, we give it to the cows, we eat the cows, we get the illness. The other thing we do, because we grow so much corn, because it's government subsidized, is that we make corn oil, and then we put it all in the packaged food. So if you're buying food off the shelves down in the package there, then you're gonna it's all full of oil. Again, the oil is associated with heart disease, obesity, diabetes. So, let's see here. This is a pill for everything approach. But let's take a look at the United States. Unrefined plant food consumption. So in green is percentage of calories from unrefined food. In red, percentage of calories, a percentage of deaths from cancer. So people in the green, these countries, they're eating a lot of plant-based food. But in countries where we don't eat much plant-based food, this is the degree, percentage of deaths from heart disease and cancer. Across countries looking at that. Let's see. This just talks about the typical American diet. Mostly oil, refined carbohydrates, all processed foods, all putting in that is what's driving the illness. So many years ago, I used to think that if someone had a heart attack, they came in and put a stent in them, and then I look in their chart and I say, wow, and then later on, I fixed your kidney artery, I fixed your leg artery, I helped you with this, I must be a really good doctor. No. What would be a good doctor is if someone came to you, they had a heart attack, that you fixed that, and then they didn't need your help anymore. So I look at it this way when I talk to my patients. If the sink is running, it's overflowing on the floor, and I just come in and just mop it up and say I took care of it, the sink's still overflowing. And that's what the food is. The food has to change. So we know that if you change your diet and you eat plant-based, then your diabetes will get much, much better or reverse. Your heart disease will reverse. The chance of cancer will go down. Osteoporosis will be better in women. Less breast cancer in women, less colon cancer. Everything gets better. This may be shocking to you. Okay, this is just a reference to a study a long time ago. It's sad that it's a long time ago, but it was the effect of taking animals. They would give them a carcinogen. In the one group of animals, they gave a plant-based diet. In the other, they gave casein, which is basically milk protein. So when we look at that, let's see, here's the effect. Cancer could be turned on and off just with changing the diet. Cancer could be turned on and off just with changing the diet, just with getting rid of the milk. This was done by Dr. Campbell many years ago in animals. And this is the effect of how much dietary protein it took to turn the cancer on and off. So let's move it forward a little bit here. I just wanted to show you this. Here's the total fat intake in a number of countries, breast cancer. So it's a percentage of breast cancer in all these countries. And we can see that the higher the fat content, the more likely there was of breast cancer. But when you break it down a little bit closer, what you found was it was really not so much the fat as fat always follows animal protein. So let's see here. Now, one of the, I think I mentioned earlier, we've known for a long time that excess of animal protein is what turns on the genes that cause these inflammatory diseases and cancer. So the truth of it is, people are worried about not getting enough protein, and yet I've yet to have a patient come in the hospital in the last 30 years protein deficient, unless they didn't eat anything. You can be protein deficient that way if you don't eat anything. But what are people coming in for is diabetes, high blood pressure, stroke, heart attack, all these things related to excess protein intake. Okay, let's see here. This is just Dr. Burkett. He was the doctor who went to Africa. And what he reported is he practiced in Uganda for 18 years. And he never found anyone who was constipated, had diverticulosis, pulmonary embolism, only one heart attack in 18 years, only one gallstone. And what he comically wrote after that is, in the United States, in Uganda, there's big bowel movements, small hospitals. In the United States, it's the opposite. Constipation, big hospitals. It's because of the fiber that really makes a difference in avoiding that. This is what happens to your cholesterol. Your cholesterol just dies. How long does it take for you to start getting better when you eat whole food plant-based? Actually, a couple of weeks. Your cholesterol gets better in a couple of weeks. You start to feel better in a couple of weeks. It takes, if you have something like diabetes, it may take a year to reverse it completely to where you're off medicines. But if you do it, and that's why a lot of these books that they write, people that promote this, they say, take the 30-day challenge, because they know after 30-day challenge, if you do it strictly, you're going to start feeling better. That's what's going to keep you on it, not just thinking about it. Okay. This goes back to the slide talking about breast cancer and fat intake. This is like separating out between fat and animal fat. And you can see there is no correlation, but it's really the animal protein that makes a correlation in breast cancer, very strong correlation. So you may ask then, people are using yogurt and as part of the sponsorship of the run for breast cancer, but yogurt is one of the things that is associated with breast cancer. See, the things I'm telling you may not have really heard before. So much so that it may be unbelievable to someone who hasn't really looked into it. This was talking about the changes that in diet. There's a large study that looked at nurses' health, and they were able to really show that primarily in the patients, in the women that were vegetarian, and much less incidence of breast cancer over time. So I just want to take a moment to, I threw a lot of things that were kind of not what you've been probably told before, but I just want to try to answer any questions about this, because it's probably raising up a lot of questions. Yes?
So the last conference we were at, they were talking about, well, he has a lot of gastrointestinal problems.
Yes.
And they were discussing how you eat vegetables, especially raw vegetables and things like that, is really hard on the gastrointestinal.
Yes.
And that they should be having like white bread and white rices and the things that are easier to digest because of the reflux and the gastrointestinal problem.
Yes.
And salads are bad for trying to digest with scleroderma.
Well, I do think in scleroderma, that's why I really want you to work with your doctor on that, because it depends in your eating plant-based things. I think you want to have awareness of your vitamin absorption, depending on your gut and your situation. Now, I don't recommend for my patients or anyone, it's okay to eat something raw, but in general, if they're slightly cooked, or they're cooked in some, it brings some of the fiber, breaks the plant up a little bit, things are more absorbable, things are more digestible. So a lot of people who are on the raw diet, I'm not a big fan of that. You can eat some raw food, obviously, but not, you can eat some coleslaw or something, but I mean, that's not what I recommend. I think when you cook things, you make it more available for absorption. Yes, yes.
So would you suggest we've been roasting most of all our vegetables?
Yes.
Just a little olive oil?
Yes. So, I say you can cook your vegetables, what you're doing, almost any way you want to cook them. Because they're whether you braise them or steam them, or really, you're not really losing nutritional value. So I think how you cook them is how they taste good to you. Have a variety, experiment with that. That's much, much more important to enjoy it and like the taste and get into that and try different things. So no matter how you want to cook it, for instance, kale, I don't care whether you just chop it or steam it, or you can boil it or put it in soups, or you can do anything you want with it, really. The nutritional value stays in that. So make it how you like it. Yes?
What about oils? First things, just olive oil is the best thing, canola oil.
So here's the thing about oil. In general, if I have patients that have an illness, such as diabetes or heart disease, I don't want them to use any oil at all. But what I recommend in that situation is steaming or sauteing things, anything else, wine, beer, vegetable juice, water, anything you want to give it that flavor. But why am I talking about oils like that? Well, number one, the reason people think olive oil is good for you is because when they do comparison studies and they look at the Mediterranean diet and such, people do better. But what is it compared to? It's compared to butter and other unhealthy oils that are high in saturated fat. So oil does better than the standard American diet. Olive oil is better than the standard American diet. But it doesn't do better than plant-based no oils. That's the lowest chance of having heart disease and reversing disease. Now specifically in diabetes, it's something you may not have been told before, but in diabetes what it is people say, well, you shouldn't eat sugar because you have a problem with sugar. Your pancreas is not working. Well, those things are correct, yes. But what it is for most patients with type 2 diabetes, particularly if they have obesity, is when you eat oil, that it poisons your insulin receptors. These are in the large muscles of your legs. When the insulin receptors are poisoned, then you have lots of insulin in your blood, but it's not getting into the cells. And eating oil is what is causing that. So what happens is if you give up meat and dairy and you give up oils completely, your insulin receptors start to work. And then they continue to work. They become unplugged. And so then your diabetes starts to become reversed. So even the small amount of oil in diabetics, part of trying to see a patient, get them off their medicines, lower their medicines, reverse the diabetes, I want them to have no oil at all. It's also a factor in reversing heart disease not to use oil. So olive oil is better than the standard American diet, but it's not better than no oil. So that's what doesn't come through. Olive oil also, if you buy the finest olive oil over in Italy, it still has the antioxidants in it. So, because it was pressed right, it wasn't mixed with other oils, it's really has a shelf life, it's much better tasting at grass than tasting, it's more expensive. But here's my point, it has the antioxidant effect. Well, this whole diet, if you're eating plant-based, you have so many antioxidants, anti-inflammatory, eating olive oil is not necessary at all, because you are already on an anti-inflammation diet. So trying to get more antioxidants by taking oil in is really a fool's journey. Now, let's just talk about fish. Almost all cardiologists tell you to eat fish. Almost all of them tell you to do that. But why? Because it has omega-3s in it. Okay? Omega-3s are good for you. You need them. You need them for your brain health, you need them for your heart health, you need them for many things. But what's not being said is that if I eat one walnut a day, that's all the omega-3s you need. That's all you need. So why are you eating, you're depleting the ocean, you're getting mercury poisoning, you're eating saturated fat to get omega-3s. By the way, the fish get it from eating greens and eating algae. You know, that's where they're getting it. So you don't need omega-3s in those kind of doses. The reason the omega-3s caught on and people are really pushing them, oh, get your fish oil and all these other things, is because when people eat meat and dairy, they're getting omega-6s that are pro-inflammatory. But then some of your food has omega-3. But you want an equal balance between 3 and 6s, but meat and dairy is full of 6s, so we better take 3 so they're an equal balance. That's the whole somewhat science behind it. But the point of it is, if you don't eat meat and dairy, you're not getting an overdose of omega-6s. Plus, there's no evidence that trying to eat 3s to catch up with the too many of the omega-6s you're eating does anything to help you. So basically, we're scooping up all the fish, putting them in pills. Patients are eating the pills, that's oil, it's associated with getting diabetes. The lens is backwards. You know, everything's changing, everything I'm telling you is sort of the opposite of what you've been told. I will put a plug in for a book that I didn't write. It's called How Not to Die. It's written by Dr. Greger. Dr. Greger is a plant-based doctor. He has been for a long time, sort of the Michael Jordan of plant-based eating. One reason I like to ask my patients to look at that book is because the last 200 pages of the book are all references. So everything he says, this is what the study showed. This is what the study showed. And it's helpful, in my view, to have something back you up that way. So you should. He also has a blog and a web page. And usually when he's talking out of the blog, he's walking on his treadmill while he's talking to him. It's very entertaining. But that's always a good starter book for get people to answer some of these questions. Yes?
Would you repeat that name again?
Yeah, so the author is Michael Greger, G-R-E-G-E-R. And his name of his book is How Not to Die. And he has a webpage called nutritionfacts.org. But it kind of helps you sort out. I gave you like 20 minutes, but this will connect you to something that gives you more information, because that's how we change. Yes?
How can you gain weight with this kind of diet?
You probably won't gain weight with this kind of diet, eating plants. And,
but what do you need to gain weight?
Well then, I think one thing is important is to look at, number one, are you taking in enough calories? Number two, if you're not taking enough calories, no matter what you're eating, you'll lose weight. And you can't just, like I said earlier, you have to eat beans, potatoes, rice, legumes, lentils, other things that have calories and starch that are actually good for you. So if you're just eating kale and celery, you'll be nutritionally deficient. That's not what the thing is. So you have to, and not only that, when you eat vegetarian, you burn more calories just digesting the food. So the same amount of calories rip the body up more, so you're gonna need more calories in order to maintain on that. The reason I particularly am happy to talk about this today is because in looking at scleroderma, it's not completely understood everything that's going on, but I'm sure your doctors want you on a diet that doesn't have inflammation, because inflammation is a way in many illnesses that make the illnesses worse. And you want to be able to do that through lifestyle adjustment. Exercises, of course, complements the diet. But I kind of made a few shocking statements today, but if you look at what's going on in the United States in terms of healthcare costs, number of people getting more obese, number of people getting more diabetes, more people getting heart disease, what's going on? And my experience, when I first learned about this about 5 or 6 years ago, I went on the diet myself as an example, then just looking at the literature, okay, I'm a heart doctor, so I'm going to see one of my patients, who's willing to go on it. And my experience has been, once they've gone on it, I've not had any more procedures to do to them. They're just healthy. Yeah. So what happens is, prior to me spending more time in understanding this, patients come in who have heart disease and say, I'm tired, I'm fatigued, and I have more chest pain, and did another procedure, this or that. Now my patients come in, they're following the diet because they give them the books to read, they give them information about it, they want to make changes in their life. And now they come in and they see me and they don't really have any complaints. And then they're talking about their recipes, talking about this or that. I'm like, well, is there anything happening? You know, no. They're very thankful because as a doctor, you told them the truth, you told them something that's evidence-based, showed them a path better. I took a Hippocratic oath to try to get my patients better, and I'm very delighted about that. So it's changed the way I approach my patients. Yes?
What is the best way to transition to this particular diet?
I'm glad you asked that. So if you were going to do that, how would you transition to it? So, first, I'll give you the short answer. The short answer is to go on it right away as rigidly as you can, because kind of what I said, it'll start helping you, and you start feeling better right away, and that's what's going to keep you on it. If you just make a gradual change, you're not going to feel any different than like, what's this doing for me? So the more you're on it, the faster you get better. Now, I tell patients that, please go on it as strictly as you can right away. That being said, none of us can do that. I couldn't do it that way when I started, because you have this refrigerator, you got this cupboard, your family's this way, and there's so much. He's mildly talking about religion, you know, talking about diet, you know. And people come to your house, why can't you eat that? Why are you weird eating this? So that's all good, you know. I mean, that's just part of the normal process. So then the patients come back. Usually it's like a confessional. Well, I did eat a hamburger. And I go, well, if you're riding your bike and you fell off, what would you do? You just get back on and ride your bike. It'll take you time. Human nature takes you time. So I know in my own family, I have a brother. He has diabetes, and he is very severe. He's on lots of medicines, and he's just not making any progress at all. But he didn't really want to go on plant-based because he was an excellent chef at making ribs and all kinds of delicious things on the grill. And, you know, there's a lot of identity around that and things. What happened is, though, that he got multiple sclerosis, which is also associated with that. When he looked at the data on that, he decided, you know, I really need to do this because of multiple sclerosis. So I was talking to him just a couple weeks ago, after he's been on it for about a year now. So now, he's 120 pounds lighter, he's not on any diabetes medicines, he's not on insulin, he feels really good. He's still struggling with the his other illness, but now he's still cooking. He's still a good cook. He's still got beautiful things he's cooking. He's realized that he can still be who he is and be a good cook. It's just actually a little more challenging now to learn how to cook that way. So I bring this up as an example. One person in the family tries to make a change, the other is, I don't know about this, or I'm not doing it. But then with time, people do this for the reason that they realize, I think the reason to do it, and for my patients, the reason to do it, they just got tired of being sick, being all these medicines and pills, and not feeling well. I'm just gonna try to make a change. So this has been a way out for my patients to realize that they have more control over their life, their illness, by making change in their diet. When I was in medical school, I was taught diet has nothing to do with illness, because you just eat whatever you want, and then your body divides it into carbohydrates, proteins, and fats, and then the body just sorts all that out and builds what it needs to build. Yeah, that's not true at all. Actually, when you eat things like animal protein and fat, your body doesn't know what to do with it, so it puts plaque at different places. It gums up your insulin receptors. It gives you illness. So what we eat is totally related to how we do. So I was given that misinformation. I was really out in practice finally. Faced to weigh, 50 pounds more, and I started looking into it and things. So, wait a minute. I think the thing, I watched the it's on Netflix called Forks Over Knives, and it said in there that you can reverse heart disease. Have I gotten the reverse heart disease? So, I think that night, my wife's here, Patty, I told her, I'm gonna eat plant-based, and she's like, I'll roll me over. So it's just something that we as a culture, that's why I kind of going back to how we grow the corn, we're just all raised this way. Most of us didn't grow up eating plant-based, but most of us are getting some illness at some point, and this is a way out. So I really appreciate the opportunity to come present to you.